Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Ungodly people, who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Now I want to remind you, although you once fully knew it, that Jesus, who saved a people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. And the angels, who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day, just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulged in sexual immorality and pursued unnatural desires, serve as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire. Yet in like manner, these people also, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glorious ones. But when the archangel Michael, contending with the devil, was disputing about the body of Moses, he did not presume to pronounce a blasphemous judgment, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." But these people blaspheme all that they do not understand, and they are destroyed by all that they, like unreasoning animals, understand instinctively. Woe to them, for they walk in the way of Cain, and abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's error, and perished in Korah's rebellion. These are hidden reefs at your love feasts, as they feast with you without fear. Shepherds feeding themselves. Waterless clouds, swept along by winds. Fruitless trees in late autumn, twice dead, uprooted. Wild waves of the sea, casting up the foam of their own shame. Wandering stars, for whom the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved forever. It was also about these that Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied, saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his holy ones, to execute judgment on all and to convict all the ungodly of all their deeds of ungodliness, that they have committed in such an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things that ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers, malcontents, following their own sinful desires. They are loud-mouthed boasters, showing favoritism to gain advantage." But you must remember, beloved, the predictions of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. They said to you, "In the last time there will be scoffers, following their own ungodly passions. It is these who cause divisions, worldly people devoid of the Spirit. But you, beloved, building yourself up in the most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourself in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now, and forever. Amen."
Do you ever stop and think that when a letter would arrive in the early church, somebody'd finally copy and send a letter, and a letter like Jude would end up in a congregation? That's how they would read it, from beginning to end. Same thing with Galatians, same thing with Corinthians, Colossians, Philippians. They would read the entire letters. We stop and we just do these little pieces. There's a big picture you can see when you read the whole thing. Before we go in and start breaking it down a little bit, what did you see? What stood out?
Dr. Barry used, when he wrote articles for the Luther Witness, he'd always end up with this doxology.
Okay. "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen." It's nice to have those in the Bible, be able to pull them out and use them in a church service. Sadly, there are churches that don't see value in that. Who wrote this book? Who wrote the Book of Jude? It says right there in the first word, right? Jude.
Brother of James.
The brother of James.
Mine says brother of Jesus and James.
Which translation is that? The ESV says, Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. A servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. Who is James?
Which one?
The one spoken of here. Which James is being spoken of?
Well, some historians say that it was Jude and James were brothers or sons of Mary and Joseph. So, I don't know if they're quite sure about that because there's some debate.
There is some debate going on. But generally speaking, I think most people assume that these are Mary and Joseph's boys that are being spoken of here. Jude is Jude. James is James. So what does that make them to Jesus?
Half-brothers.
Half-brothers, right. Why are they half-brothers, not whole brothers?
Because Joseph wasn't the father of Jesus.
Yeah, pretty simple.
I was going to say, Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit.
Nah.
Same thing.
Close enough.
Is it possible that some people believe that it might be brother James the disciple? The apostle?
You mean the son of Zebedee?
The son of Zebedee?
Yeah.
Or James the Less.
Well, I'm talking about
brother James, John,
Jude Christ 12.
Yeah.
That there was a James.
Yeah.
I was wondering.
Yeah. There's some debate as to exactly who. What does Jude not focus on in that opening sentence? Yeah. Where he says, Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. What is he not focusing on there? And what is he focusing on?
The inspiration of God. Makes it sound like it's just coming from Jude.
Well, everybody who wrote letters back then, remember in the old days?
I'm trying to help you out here. I don't
no. know. Well, he's... What could he have said? What could Jude have said? This is Jude, the brother of the Messiah, the brother of Jesus. But he doesn't say that. He says the brother of James, but a servant of Jesus. What does that tell you about him?
He's humble,
yeah.
Or maybe he doesn't want to throw that up right away because people would write him off. Maybe he wants people to tune in before he...
Is it him?
Yeah.
Well, if he's the brother of Jesus, he might or might not be, you know.
Yeah, he's changing. question, what did we get or what did we see in there?
What did you see in there? The big picture is what I was aiming for.
The big picture is that he does a little bit of history, letting them know, he's, I'm going to tell you something you already know, and I'm going to tell you, but we're being attacked. There are these people out there, the dreamers, the guys who don't understand, the guys who use the scriptures for their immorality. And then he says, but hang in there. The one who's able to protect you is the same guy I introduced you to in verse 1.
Yep. Yeah.
Last Saturday, my doorbell rings. I look out, and there's two ladies dressed, nicely dressed. So you know who's there. Jehovah Witnesses are there. And I said, oh, these girls are in trouble. I learned a lot from those. Did you know? And I think that's who we're talking about here. They are people who don't understand. And they believe with all their heart that they're right. And you can't, I said, you got your Bible? Look, first of all, they use a different translation than you and I use.
Right. They have their own.
I had read Ephesians 3:9, and you could barely understand what in the world they were saying. For my grace, I can say it through faith. It's not of yourself. Gift of God. And they didn't, they read it, but I went, golly, let me see. So I took the Bible and looked at the translation. Sure enough, it's done by somebody else, somebody I've never heard of before. But they when it said they don't understand, these are devout believers, just like the Muslims are devout believers. And they believe with all their heart that Jesus was just a prophet, not the Son of God. The Holy Spirit is Jesus' spirit. And
which primarily understood is true.
And then there's no heaven because there's going to be earth restored and hell of some sort. And they don't believe in the trumpet's going to sound. And, you know, they don't believe that. They don't believe that. And you just go, it doesn't matter what you say to them. They are just so tuned in to what that little bit that they know.
They're very well trained.
They are.
They're very well trained before they're sent out.
My parting words were, so believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Believe what about it? Well, that he was the Son of God, just like you and I are the Son of God. And I go, that's not what it says. I can't save anybody. Jesus has to be God in order to save. So my final words were, I'm sorry that you and I will not be spending eternity together. Because if you reject Jesus Christ, Jesus plainly says, I and the Father are one. And they just reject all that. It's just, or they have an understanding of it.
Yeah.
And I said, do you understand that you're going against mainstream Christianity? Because mainstream Christianity, Catholic, Lutheran, Baptist, Methodist, we all pretty well understand Jesus Christ is Lord. And that he died for our sins, and if we believe that, eternity will be ours. But so you got to believe it. Somebody's responsible for their souls. And I think this is what they're trying to guard against here. But these people are the dreamers, and the people who don't understand, the people who are perverting everything Jesus did.
So, who wrote the Book of Jude? The Holy Spirit wrote the Book of Jude. Right? Jude is the author, whoever, or a scribe with a pen that he spoke to. But ultimately, the entire scripture is written under the inspiration. It's the word of God. It's what God would have written down.
Well, same time, Chris, I think it's important to talk about the authorship of the book because that gets to the very question of, is this truly scripture? Because as you well know, I'm sure, this is one of the disputed books.
Mm-hmm.
Luther did not think much of it, apparently. And a lot of it had to do was this book written by an apostle? Did it reflect apostolic teaching?
Mm-hmm.
And so the question of who wrote Jude cuts to me to the heart of how much faith should we put in this book?
Right.
And I think, I mean, personally, I'm inclined to think it's scripture, but maybe I'm wrong. It's possible that Jude isn't scripture. In my head, I admit that. But what that means to me simply is, if there's an idea expressed in Jude that I don't see anywhere else in scripture, and I'm not sure what I believe about it, then I'm not going to put a lot of weight on that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. In other words, I'm not going to base a doctrine on something that's found only in Jude,
right,
or only in
James.
Yeah.
And right. the church would be behind that same notion. The church has the homilogamina and the antilogamina, if you're familiar with those terms. Jude is considered inspired scripture, but it's not considered primary, if you can make that distinction, right?
Sure.
It's still scripture, but it's not where you go to for doctrine. James is scripture, but it's not where you go to as your primary, your magisterial, if you will, place to go for scripture, for doctrine. If you find something there, look for it somewhere else. Look in the Gospels first, then look in other writings, you know, Acts, Romans.
Isn't Hebrews one of the antilogamina also?
I believe it is, yeah.
Well, see, one of the things I've noticed over the years is some of the biggest arguments people get into are over things taught in the book of Hebrews. Like the issue of, once you fall away, can you return to the faith? Interpreted a certain way, Hebrews seems to say no. But that's the only place in Scripture where that seems to be taught. And so I think we have to be careful when we use a proof text just from one of these books.
Right.
Unless it's something clearly taught in the rest of Scripture. Yeah.
And that was why I wanted to sort of do a study, maybe after Jude we'll do this, is looking at proof text, basically. Looking at single lines of Scripture that people pull out and make doctrine over. They make all these big 40-minute sermons about a text and the proof texting, as opposed to exegeting. So that we can kind of go into those texts and look around them, look in their context, and see what they really say. But for now, we're on Jude. So we accept it as inspired, and we move forward. Who are those who are called? That's a good question, right? Because it starts out saying, to those who are called. Well, who are those who are called? We have a couple of scripture references here. From 1 Corinthians 1:24, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and wisdom of God. Who are those who are called? It's not just the Jews. Why is it not just the Jews? They're the God's chosen people. Right? But we ought always to give thanks to God for you, brothers beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as first fruits to be saved through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. 2 Thessalonians 2:13. So when he addresses this letter to those who are called, beloved in God the Father and kept for Jesus Christ, who is he talking to?
To the church.
Right. Why is that important? Why is it important that we understand that this letter is written to the church? We assume every book in the Bible is written to the church, but why is it important that we really understand that it's written to the church?
Well, it helps you to understand where he's coming from.
And where he's going.
Yeah.
Yeah. Every book in the Bible is written for a reason, written for our instruction, written to show us God, to reveal Christ. It's all one big revelation, right? We have a book called Revelation, but really the scriptures are all one big revelation, showing us Christ. So, to those who are called, and it's not just the Jews, it's the Jews and the Greeks, it's the Jews and everybody. The Gentiles.
I wanted to mention that it's interesting to me. Notice the first verse you have there, it says those who are called.
Mm-hmm.
And then the second verse you have there from 2 Thessalonians says
those who are chosen.
Because God chose you.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes me think of the words of Jesus. Many are called, but few are chosen.
Mm-hmm.
Which, boy, that one's been debated forever.
Oh, yeah.
But I think in Jude, he includes both the same concept.
Yeah, I think the called there is the church. It's those who are called. It's not to the world. He's not writing it to the unbelieving world. Right?
I was connected to called with my version, it says kept.
Kept. Okay, well, kept is in there also.
I understand.
But, yeah.
And then I connect that to shepherd and sheep.
Okay.
So...
Oh, nice.
Shepherd calls us,
yeah.
And we are kept by.
Yeah. Okay. He's writing this to the church. This is a letter that's intended to be circulated. It's not intended for a particular, that was just written to that group of people. It's a letter written to the church. To those who are called, beloved in God the Father.
Luther felt this was a copy of 2 Peter.
Yeah, yeah. And he wasn't alone in that. Yeah. Well, not a copy, but
extract.
Yeah, it was as if there was a belief that because of a lot of the similarities in the language and similarities in the theme, that this was somebody had seen the letter of 2 Peter and had, you know.
Well, that's one of the arguments against its canonicity.
Yeah, but it made it. If it was copied in its style, it doesn't repeat Peter's words word for word, though. Right? It may be like similar in style, similar in thought, but it's not a just a verbatim copy.
Well, you know, earlier when I said, you know, to be scripture, it has to be apostolic, and obvious exceptions are things like Mark. But the church has always understood that to mean Mark was an associate of Peter. Luke was an associate of Paul. So it was either written by an apostle or one of their close associates. Maybe that's who Jude was. Maybe
or somebody
was
who personally had...
Apostle Peter.
Somebody who had personally seen the Christ. I mean, that's included in that if you're an apostle. But also, there were people who probably came later who considered themselves apostles, but they had never actually met Jesus. So that's one of the factors that's generally in there, you know.
Well, I'm just saying, maybe that's who Jude is. Maybe he knew Peter and was an associate of his. That's why their letters are so similar.
Yeah, could be. Yeah,
maybe he cribbed from...
Could be that the Holy Spirit wanted to get the same message out with some additional encouragements, some additional messages.
But whether it's plagiarized or not, it's still the same message.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that word Jeff brought up, kept, comes up. Kept for, in the ESV, kept for Jesus Christ. Kept for him. It's interesting, not kept in him, kept with him. Kept for.
We talk about the meaning of the third article is that the Holy Spirit keeps us in the faith, maintains and keeps us in the faith, and in that sense, it's proper to think of kept as making us still tight with Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
The gospel.
Right. One of the things that should always be encouraged is for people to attend worship where the Word of God is read and preached, and to attend Bible studies that are, honestly, they need to be Bible studies, where you read the Word of God and you study the Word of God. Why would that be something we should encourage people to do? Say again?
That's a source of faith.
It's a source of faith, yeah. It is the means God provides for us to bring people to faith through the preaching of the Word and to keep people in the faith through the preaching of the Word and the study of the Word. That's the way God keeps us. How long do you have to stop studying Scripture and just live in the world before the world will become your primary source of influence? Well, I studied the Scriptures for 25 years. I'm good to go. I don't have to study them ever again, and I can go out there and I won't be affected by the world. True or false?
Very false.
Right? The world will win if you don't stay focused, if you don't stay fed.
Do you ask how long?
Yeah, sort of how long. But, I mean, would it take long? It depends on each person, right? But it will happen. It might, if somebody, for instance, a pastor who's been to seminary and studied not only the Scriptures and the Confessions, but who knows how many other sources, let's say he just puts all his books on his shelf and never opens his tablet and reads a Bible Gateway or whatever and just starts doing his living life, you know, not studying anymore, not, can he just rely on his memory to keep him in the faith? His memory of the Scriptures?
No.
Why not?
That's our human nature. It's the door our own way.
Yeah.
We rebel even if we're in the Scriptures.
Even while we're studying the Scriptures, we're rebelling against the Scriptures.
What he just said about a pastor made me think of something I read online a while back. They were talking. The context of the comment was talking about these megachurch pastors, where you have, you know, basically the only time you see the senior pastor is when he's in the pulpit on Sunday, and then the rest of the time he does not personally visit members or whatever, and you know, visit the sick, that kind of thing. And what this person said was they're expecting the sheep to be able to fend off the wolf based on something the shepherd said to them months ago that's in their memory. And when you said his memory, that's what made me think of that. because he was basically, the author was saying, the shepherd needs to be out there helping the sheep, encouraging them.
Right.
Because when you're in a crisis in your life, you need someone there with you, not just the memory of something that somebody told you a long time ago.
Yeah. And I think along with that, you need to be able to trust and accept what comes from outside of you. The Word of God spoken to you by a pastor, read in class, that kind of thing. And by that, I mean, some people avoid having people come visit them and speak the truth to them because they just don't want to hear it, right?
Well, even if they come visit you, they don't want to hear it.
Yeah. So, we have this word kept, and in John, Jesus, it says, in John it says, and I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one even as we are one. So this is Jesus speaking.
I wonder if that verse is in the Jehovah's Witnesses Bible, just as we are one.
That's just we are one.
But it's a dollar, it's not translated.
Or they just interpret it differently.
Oh, it's in there. They just interpret.
Keep them in your name. Keep them in your name. How important is God's name to God? How important is God's name to God?
Made a commandment about it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one. Remember in the book of Revelation, who was in the Revelation study at least once? There's this idea of being sealed, and being sealed and being given a new name. I like to think of that as that's when you're baptized. That's when you are called now Christian. It's not that I am now Christopher Robert B. Jacob B. Hogan because I've got a new name because I'm a Christian. The end is near, Jim.
The end is near.
The end is near.
Last sheet.
It's the new name. You are now called by his name. You are now a Christian. You are a Christ bearer and a Christ follower, even if your name isn't Christopher. So, keep them in your name which you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. Keep them in the faith. Keep them in the one true faith. Right? I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. So what is God? What's another way God keeps us? He guards us and he protects us and he keeps us from the evil one. By us leaving our book on the shelf and never opening it and never studying it. By us not going to church and hearing the Word of God rightly preached and taught.
You know that magazine Good News?
Mm-hmm.
The Wallace Schultz thing? He had this really good article once about why it's important to stay in the Word. And the analogy he used was glaucoma. And he said, if you have glaucoma, you have to take these drops every day. And if you don't take drops every day, you'll lose your eyesight. You can't see anymore. And he said, when God gives us his word and he enlightens our understanding, then that's like you can see spiritually. But if you don't keep taking the medicine, the word and the sacraments, eventually you'll lose it. Mm-hmm. And he said that's the way sin is. It never goes away in this life. So you constantly have to keep fighting it off with the word. I thought that was a great analogy.
That is.
Because then you lose, if you don't take the word, then you think you don't need it. And so when people stop going to church, they're like, I don't need that stuff anymore. And they don't realize they do, but they're just not. It's right. Like freezing to death. You can get to the point where you don't think you are.
Well, things don't fall apart right away. Things take time. And it's like, well, see, I stopped going to church and things are okay. I stopped reading my Bible and things are okay.
Now, I will often wonder, you know, you hear some sermons that you need to be in Scripture every day. And so forth like that. I'm not sure that I agree with that 100%. I've heard it from the pulpit quite a few places. And my gut feeling is if you are an established Christian, you can, if you go to church once a week or listen to Lutheran Hour once a week, you're really okay. And just looking at it from a human nature standpoint, I think a person at least me, if I was said I had to read this scripture every day like some people do, I think it would tend to get boring. I wouldn't like it. I'd kind of tend to rebel. How do the rest of y'all feel about that?
I think we should only eat food 5 days a week or 2 days a week. I can get by with 2 days a week. Maybe. And what I eat doesn't really matter. I could have chocolates. Because chocolate is supposed to be a medication now. I mean, I'm being facetious, but if we take it for eating, for our body, what about our soul?
Right. We're studying on Sunday mornings.
Too much of a good thing.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't have too much. Can you have too much scripture?
Can we go to the Lord's Supper too often?
Can you be too heavenly minded to be of any earthly good? I hate that saying, actually. You can't be any earthly good if you're not heavenly minded.
I have to force myself to be in the Word. My human nature doesn't want me to be in the Word. So I've got to make it convenient. You know, I've got to put a devotional book in the bathroom. I've got to force myself, even though I'm going through my emails, I'm going, there's a devotion, I'm better for that. Force myself to do that. Does that mean I don't love the Word? I don't know. I think it just means that the forces of evil don't want me there. So I've got, you know, I think it's important to be in the Word every day because I'm a coward. Because I know I'm not strong enough to fight this by myself. I need help. And I disagree 100%. I know this boy here needs to be in the Word, not just once a day, but many times a day. Not because it's a good luck charm, not because God looks down and says, oh, that's my Garrett, he's a little boy, he's in there every day. I need it for me.
Rudy.
Even though you're reminded of the same thing.
Oh, I don't think that's true at all. There is so much in this book, and there's so many different ways to study it, and so many different things to learn, and I never get bored of it.
If we're getting bored with Scripture, well, go ahead, Rudy. That's
don't
another
you
topic.
Think about Scripture every day when you pray? You think about Scripture verses.
You do, right? Okay. In your prayers, you recall a verse, or you're praying
so
something.
You're really in the Word. Any time you think about Scripture and about God revealed in the Bible.
That's why I brought up memory earlier. Is it better for me to remember a scripture? It's not a bad thing, but is it better for me to remember it than for me to open the actual book and read it while I'm praying?
I don't think you can say one or the other. That's like saying, is it better to hug or kiss your wife?
Well, what can happen if you just rely on your memory when you're dealing with scripture? That's the point. The point is that our memories will fail us. Our memories will manipulate the scripture at times to say what we want it to say. So it's just more relying on the actual text. Now, that's not to say that using your memory in prayer is a bad thing or wrong either. It's just keeping it in check with what's actually on the paper.
Perhaps I was inspired by Jude when we read through Jude. Thinking of the heavenly angels,
mm-hmm.
Were they close to God?
Kind of.
Close to God all the time. There was no time, but were they close to God all the time? Yes. Then why did some fall away? Even angels can fall away, and Jude talks about that. The angels who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling.
Right.
They left their proper dwelling. And I think about, could that be applied to human beings, Christians?
Sure. It's a point of comparison
that
in the letter.
Close to God, we always have to be moved by the Holy Spirit to get in, hear God speak to us often.
It's not easy to study on a daily basis.
Being in the Scripture, I'm assuming several different forms. Gary talked about reading the little prayer.
The devotional book, yeah.
That's one way. When you talked about when you pray, you're being in the Scripture. Other ways, when you run into people and you just talk about faith or Christianity or what your experience. I always assume those are all being in the scripture.
I agree with that.
If I go and sit in a bar and I'm talking to a friend about experience, Christianity, that's being in the scripture, even though I'm sitting in a bar. It doesn't mean... A lot of us come to church and we listen to what the pastors say. That's being in the scripture. So
okay.
I think it comes in a lot of different forms. It doesn't mean... And I can't say, yeah, you can get boring and if your heart is not in it and you're reading it, it doesn't mean anything.
Yes.
So I think if you're sitting there discussing without the book about biblical stuff or life experience, it's being in the scripture, your heart might be in it more rather than when you force yourself to read a verse or a chapter every day. So I think it's just, there's different forms. Just like when a person preaches, some of them preach on an open, on the radio, some preach on TV, some preach to an audience.
Yeah, there's many different ways to be in the Word for sure. I don't rely on my memory very much because I can't remember. I can sort of remember a passage, but I'm usually remembering it from the NIV, and then I usually miss something. So I have to actually, if I'm going to study on something, I have to think about what I think I'm remembering, go to the NIV translation and find it, and then go to the ESV to get, you know, text, you know, the way I'm going to use it, because my memory is stuck in the NIV. But I don't always get all the words right. If I'm missing certain words, I might be messing with scripture, and that could be dangerous. So I was just being reminded. I said this bold statement once, and I was wrong. I said, you know, if you follow the three-year lectionary, in 3 years, you've worked your way through the entire Bible. Well, it's true, but it's not true. It's true in that you've worked your way through the entire Bible, but you haven't gotten every single word in the Bible. What you've gotten is about 90% of the New Testament, and it's only like about 40 or 50% of the Old Testament, but then that's skipping a bunch of stuff. Like, yeah, it's like who begat who begat who begat who, and that's gone for chapters, you know. So the nice thing about the following a lectionary is that if you sit in church pretty much every Sunday for 3 years, you've been filled with the Word of God. And then if you repeat that for the 3 years after that, you've been filled once again with the Word of God. Now, I'm going to confess to you that as a Catholic, about the time I was my son's age, I was like, I got it. You guys quote something, I've heard it before, I got it, I don't need to hear it again, you know, and that's why I kind of drifted away from going to church on a regular basis. I was just hearing the same thing over and over and over again. I was very immature. I didn't realize that I needed to keep hearing it over and over and over again.
A couple things I want to mention in the thing I was going to originally say. One is, I know a pastor here in the area that preaches on, okay, you know how the lectionary you have for year A, B, and C, right? Mm-hmm. A is mostly Matthew, B is Luke, or Mark, and then Luke. He preaches on only the Old Testament lessons for 3 years, all 3 years. They preach on only the epistles for 3 solid years. So in 9 years, he's going to preach over every text in the lectionary. I think that's kind of cool. Another thing is, when Mark was a little girl, we were using Concordia Publishing House materials for Sunday school here. Well, the thing I like about Concordia Publishing House is the Sunday school lesson for the kids is almost always the gospel or the Old Testament reading for that Sunday, and it follows the lectionary. And so if you send your kid to Sunday school over a certain number of years, that kid's going to be exposed to like 95% of the passages that are read in church. And that is a pretty comprehensive exposure to the scriptures and their stories. And so I think that's a solid thing that they've always had going on. But what I was going to say earlier, talk about what Ken was saying, this reminds me of being a teacher. No one teacher has all the answers. There's always, every teacher has their own tricks. You know, oh, this works for me, I've tried this, or I've done this with my kids, and all that. And I've been teaching 28 years, and every year I'll meet some teacher that'll say, oh, I'm doing this in my class, and I'll go, wow, that's a great idea. That is really cool. I never thought of that. I want to try that. And what I think would be really, really good, in fact, I'll suggest this right here for all of us guys sitting right here. I would love to have some kind of a forum where people could share the different forms of devotion that they use in their personal life. Like, how often do you pray? What do you say when you pray? What kind of Bible study do you use? What do you find helpful? What do you find not helpful? And then if we all pooled those together, people could look at that and say, you know, that's something I'm going to try, because one of the things I believe very strongly is in teaching is it doesn't have to be brilliant. It just has to be. Like in devotionals, I think reading Portals of Prayer every day, as brief as it is, and reading that cheesy little prayer, and sometimes they're not very good, I think it's better to do that on a daily basis than have the most brilliant quiet time 3 times a month. I think consistency is important, but it doesn't have to be anything huge. You know, it's like exercise. Every January, you're like, oh man, I gotta lose weight, I gotta get in shape. And everybody has these big ambitions, and because you set your sights too high, you give up. And I think that's true in the spiritual life, too. We think, oh yeah, this year I'm going to read the Bible all the way through, you know. I said that in 2011, and I still haven't finished it yet. I'm still in the Psalms, okay? But I'm still plugging, you know, every couple times a week. Oh yeah, I got to read my Bible. Okay.
So. The nice thing that makes, it's like the reason I brought up the lectionary is, if you sat in a church following the three-year lectionary, in 3 years, you've largely heard, not read personally, but you've heard a very large percentage of Scripture.
Sure.
And I mean, so it's all gone in. And then when you read it yourself later, it could trigger something.
Jim mentioned exercise and what related to reading the Bible. One of the key things to keep exercising is that you do it with somebody else.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I think together with another person or more is helpful, too, to keep into the Word. Because you talked about Portals of Prayer. That reminded me, I haven't read it in the last 5 days. I better get with it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, add it to me.
Guilt.
Well, I don't know. It might be something
accountability.
Yes, with my devotions with Luther and things like that. And so,
yeah.
Talking about this, like you said, different ideas and sort of inspires me just to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wasn't going to come this morning, by the way, because I thought there wasn't going to be any, but perhaps there would be. Maybe I should come and see what it's like, and I'll do. And I'm glad I came.
There you go.
And things change. Everybody doesn't have to do Portals of Prayer. Everybody can do something else, like Jim was saying. What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing?
Yeah.
Years ago, I was faithful to the Portals of Prayer. I just forget to open it now.
It's okay.
You know, and that's okay because I'm not.
CMS or something.
I'm not out of the Word. There's Word going on. I'm studying something on my in my car, listening to something, or when I get to work and I have lunch, you know, studying something, whatever. You find those times and you make it. And the more you do it, honestly, I think the more you want to do it. I don't think, Ken, for me at least, that the more I do it, the more boring it gets. I think the more I do it, the more I got to do it. The more I feel weird if I didn't do it.
Plus, there's always that wonderful feeling of smug self-righteousness when you
especially on Facebook. Yes.
Let's not lie and say we don't think that.
Especially on Facebook.
No, I run into the situation. I'm just too darn busy.
Oh yeah.
To do that.
Yeah.
Sure.
And,
yeah. Oh yeah.
And you know, I guess I'm getting on the wrong track. But
how's that one going to work in front of the throne, Ken?
Well, as long as the bottom line, I don't know. I feel I'd be a results-oriented person. I pretty much do anything.
You got to force yourself.
Yeah.
I'm serious. Force myself, and I'm not saying that it's just not a natural thing.
This is an entire study of Jude, by the way. One sheet.
Everybody thinks I come here just to make coffee, but I did get something.
Well, I hope you get something out of it. There's a group it's a group of Lutheran pastors that create a daily devotional. And I had happened to find one on Jude in there, which was good. And it's a single page. But they teach you a process. You know, you're going to listen to the they go listen, read, mark, and learn, basically. It's like you're going to read the word, you're going to pay attention to certain things in it, and then you're going to learn from it, that kind of thing.
You got to me this morning here. I think this is I'd like to do one of these forums too, but I'd like to do it with parents who, what did you do to keep your children in the faith?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the Holy Spirit thing. But, you know, I hear that all the time from people. They say, you know, well, every Sunday we had a church and Sunday school, and yet my son fell away. You know, I would like to see a 100 parents who said, what worked for you? What was the thing that, if you had to go through a whole thing, what was the one thing that contributed to it? Was it that he was in Lutheran school? Was it that he had grandparents living next door? What was it? Because I remember old Hans Heidler, one time he said, why is it you got all these kids and they all go to the same church, they all go to the same pastor, same Sunday school teacher, and this guy's a believer and this guy isn't? What caused that?
Right.
And I think that would be huge to, you know, especially for young parents. I want to hear what worked for Jolly over here. How did you do that? Because here's your son sitting there right next to you. How did that work? You know, what was the guiding light there? I think that would be...
And you're going to find people that are going to be really good at it. And you're going to find people that are going to just be miserable when you say that to them, because they're going to go, I have the best intentions.
Show up for it.
I have the best intentions with my kids, but I don't do it.
I think the ones that would show up are the ones who really are trying to do, you know, I would love to have my children sit there in that and say, and learn from him what worked, or, well, oh, don't ever do this. If we had one mistake, this is our mistake, you know? All right, Jim.
Go, Jim.
Rebuttal time.
I was just thinking about the walking along the way thing.
I think every family is affected by that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's challenging to have any kind of daily time.
You're talking about having a study after Jude about proof texts that are often ripped out of context and abused. I think one of the number top 10 has to be Proverbs 22, whatever it is. Train a child in the way he should go, because I am telling you, there is no solution. There isn't. There is no formula. There is no magic key to keeping your child faithful. Because I have seen Christian parents who did everything right, and some of their children still fell away. And if you talk about what works and what doesn't, in my opinion, all you're going to do is drive those people into despair and guilt.
Well, you take a book of wisdom and you turn it into something that it's not.
Well, not just that. But I'm simply saying there is no magic formula.
Yeah.
God has no grandchildren.
I don't agree with that. I don't think there's a magic formula, but I believe there are things, decisions parents make along the way that have a tremendous influence on their child.
I don't disagree with that, but I do disagree that a parent can make a child or produce a Christian child by going ABC. I don't think that's taught in the Bible, and it's not true. I simply refuse to believe that.
Then why does I don't think that's a promise, bring up a child, but I believe it's certainly guidance. You bring up that child in the way that you should go, and in front of the throne, you can say, Father, I brought him up.
And when he is old, he will not depart from it.
I don't believe that's a promise. I believe it's
Well, that text, the way I've heard it over the years, is not even referring to what it's supposed to be referring to. It's like, oh, bring him up, find out what his bent is, find out if he's supposed to be an engineer or a doctor or a lawyer, find out what his bent is and train him up to be that.
Well, it's not about the spiritual.
That is exactly not what it's about. But that's what everybody makes it about.
What do y'all think? I've pretty much come to the conclusion on that subject that it would be a good idea for the church to at least offer a course, not necessarily make it mandatory, but at least offer a course in Proverbs to all kids that are confirmed or directly prior to confirmation or directly after confirmation. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you what that does. That will all, if they really learn those principles, it not will only contribute to their spiritual health, but it will also prepare them more what they'll find in the world. Because, you know, if you really take Proverbs to heart and do it, I think you're going to be more successful. You know, even in mundane situations. I think if I had to do that all over with my kids, I would really, you know, in their formative years in high school, and well, not necessarily their formative years, but I mean, in high school times and so forth like that, have a devotion on Proverbs and talk about it.
What's the point of Proverbs? Not to get distracted, we're not going to get to verse 2, but or whatever, we're still on verse 2. Why was the book written in a sense? What's the point of Proverbs?
To fashion your life after.
Is it wisdom to fashion your life after? Okay. So it's a book of law?
For attaining wisdom and discipline, for understanding words of insight, for acquiring a disciplined and prudent life.
For understanding? For understanding what's right. For coming to the knowledge of the truth. Right?
The dangers of exclusive of Proverbs is it can become moralistic.
Right.
And you could read that book and you're Jehovah's Witness or any good person and follow it, but not to have the thread of the gospel of Jesus Christ woven in it.
Right.
Into it.
Right.
So
something that's often left out of it is Jesus. It's all a book of law to a lot of people. It's here's how what you do. Here's how you live. Here's how you're a better person. Here's how you please God.
I constructed a neat Bible study on Jesus and the Proverbs.
Yeah. I'm studying on Proverbs in the background right now. So we're about at verse 6, or chapter 6, almost going on to 7. So in time, be through the entire book. We're going to go ahead and close. I know that we didn't quite get everywhere, which is good, because that gives me stuff that's prepared for next week. So there'll be more on Jude next week. It's a short book. We'll try not to take a year to get through it.
Can't wait until we get to the 7th from Enoch.
Yeah.
First,
yeah. Yeah. That's going to be good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And all kinds of things
say about that. Oh, I imagine so. Okay. Well, let's just go ahead and close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for blessing us to be here and be about the study of your word. We ask your blessing on our week coming up. We ask your healing hand to be put on those who are in need of it, Lord. Particularly, I think of my son and his cancer treatments, but there's many people, Lord, that have needs also, and we pray that you will touch them and heal them also. And we just ask you to be with us as we go about our week. Keep us in your word, Lord. Keep us focused on our vocations, and when we have opportunity, Lord, help us to share the truth. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.